हेलो, दिस इज शिव गणेश, लेक्चर इन जूलॉजी, एमआर कॉलेज, विजयनगर. टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ हार्ट. ओके,
ओके, लेट अस डिस्कस अबाउट द स्ट्रक्चर एंड फंक्शनिंग ऑफ हार्ट. फर्स्टली आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस द सर्कुलेटरी सिस्टम. The system that circulates blood and lymph through body consisting of heart, blood vessels, blood, lymph and the lymphatic vessels and glands. Okay, the circulatory system is mainly two types. They are closed circulatory system and open circulatory system. Firstly, we have to discuss the closed circulatory system. Closed circulatory system in the sense the blood circulates within the blood vessels. There are no gaps. The blood is not filled in the cavity, I mean body cavity. The closed circulatory system, it has the blood closed at all times within vessels, which means blood vessels of different size and wall thickness. In this type of system, blood is pumped by a heart through vessels and does not normally fill body cavities. Earlier I have told you. Next. Okay. Open circulatory system. Open circulatory systems are the systems where blood rather than being sealed tight in arteries and veins, suffuses the body and may be directly open to the environment at places such as the digestive tract. It also contains immune cells. But in the sense the hemolymph, which is colorless, which doesn't have red blood cells, that's why it is colorless. Just look at the images. This is open circulatory system. The blood vessels are not well developed, that's why there are gaps between. Here the closed circulatory system, there is no gap, it continues. Okay, this is a closed circulatory system. Okay, next slide. Okay, let's observe different organisms or the animals which are possessing different modes of circulatory methods. Let us discuss them. Firstly, we have to discuss from protozoa, Porifera and cnidarians, which are also called coelenterates, and also Ctenophora phylum, and also Platyhelminthes nematoda. All these phyla, the circulation is performed in protozoa, Porifera, cnidaria, Ctenophora, Platyhelminthes and Nematyhelminthes, the organisms which belong to the phyla. The circulation is performed by diffusion, because any circulatory organs are not appeared, I mean which are not formed in the phyla. So the circulation is performed by diffusion method, I mean the process. Okay, next, Annelida. Next phylum, Annelida. Annelida has a closed circulatory system. The circulatory system, I mean, basically we have to discuss the system. System means, firstly we have to discuss a cell. Cell is a structural and functional unit of our body. Some group of cells form tissue. Some group of tissues form organ. Some group of organs form a system, whether it is a digestive system or respiratory system or circulatory system. Circulatory system which means it possesses the related organs like heart and blood vessels, blood, all these. So this is a circulatory system. It was first appeared in Annelida, which is closed circulatory system. Next slide. Okay, next arthropoda. Arthropoda, the organisms which belong to the arthropoda, they have an open circulatory system, which means the blood is in the blood cavities, body cavities. The open circulatory system pumps the blood into a cavity called hemocele. Hemocele, which means the body cavity which is filled with the blood, which is called hemocele, where it surrounds the organs and then returns to the heart through ostia, which are the openings, pores, small pores, apertures. The blood found in arthropods, a mix of blood and interstitial fluid, which is also called hemolymph, which is colorless because the hemolymph doesn't have blood cells. Hence, have blood cells, which means the blood cells which are having respiratory pigment. The respiratory pigment is absent in them. Hence, the blood is colorless. The blood of the arthropods, which is called hemolymph. Next slide. Okay. Mollusca. Mollusca has an open circulatory system. In an open circulatory system, blood is not contained entirely in enclosed blood vessels. We have discussed earlier. The heart pumps blood through blood vessels that lead from the gills into the body cavities called hemocoels. Gills, which means the molluscans are the aquatic forms, that's why they are having the gills, their respiratory organs. So the heart pumps blood through blood vessels that lead from the gills into the body cavities called hemocoels. We have discussed earlier hemocoels, which are the body cavities which are filled with the blood, which are called hemocoels. Okay, right. Next, cephalopods. Cephalopods, which exclusively they belong to the mollusca, but the exclusive characters of cephalopods here we have to mention. The cephalopods are the only mollusk with a closed circulatory system. All molluscans they are having an open circulatory system, whereas the cephalopods exclusively they are having closed circulatory system, similar to annelids. Okay, in the cephalopods, coloids, whatever it is, dibranchiata have two gill hearts, also known as branchial heart. Gill hearts or branchial hearts, so they are having that move blood through the capillaries of the gills. A single systemic heart then pumps the oxygenated blood through the rest of the body. Okay, next slide. Okay, let us discuss echinoderms. Echinoderms, they have an open circulatory system with cilia circulating the fluid through each arm. Echinoderms have a network of fluid-filled canals that function in gas exchange, feeding, and in movement. The network contains a central ring and areas which contain the tube feet which stretch along the body or arms. Next, we have to discuss hemichordates. The bodies of hemichordates are divided into three parts: proboscis, collar, and trunk. They have open circulatory system and a complete digestive tract, but the musculature in their gut is very poorly developed, and food is mostly transported through it by using the cilia that cover its inside surface. Okay, I have to tell you one thing. In some of the books, they are mentioning the hemichordates are having closed circulatory system. I have referred many books that the hemichordates are having an open circulatory system. Okay, just observe it. Next slide. Okay, chordates. All we know that the circulatory system in chordates has a characteristic pattern. In tunicates, they are the primitive chordates. In tunicates and vertebrates, the blood is propelled by a distinct heart. In cephalochordates, by contraction of blood vessels. Okay, once again I am repeating this. In tunicates and vertebrates, the blood is propelled by a distinct heart. Heart is present, which means in cephalochordates, the blood is propelled by contraction of blood vessels. In tunicates and cephalochordates, capillaries are absent. We have to discuss this. Okay, I mean, here there is a small confusion. Capillaries only absent in tunicates and cephalochordates, but blood vessels are present in cephalochordates. Just remember that. And the blood passes through spaces, the tissues instead, in cephalochordates and tunicates. Cephalochordates and all vertebrates have closed circulatory systems. Here you have to observe. Okay, only tunicates are having open circulatory system. Cephalochordates and all vertebrates are having a closed circulatory system. But okay, next slide. Okay, let's observe the chambers of heart. Firstly, cyclostomes. Okay, cyclostomes are having the rounded mouth, which belong to aneta, which means jawless vertebrates. Okay, the cyclostomes are having two chambered heart, one atrium and one ventricle. The two chambers are one is atrium and second one is ventricle. Fishes also, the first jawed vertebrates, which are also having, the fishes are also having two chambered heart with one atrium and one ventricle. Atrium is also called auricle. Right. Next, amphibians. Just how interestingly the evolution is performed in nature. Firstly, cyclostomes and fishes are having two chambered heart. Then the three chambered heart was appeared in amphibians. With the next generation, amphibians are having three chambered heart with two atria or auricles, two auricles and one ventricle. This is also called the mixed heart, which means the impure blood and pure blood are mixed in the ventricle. Hence, this kind of heart is called mixed heart. Fish's heart is called sinus heart or branchial heart. Amphibian's heart is called mixed heart. Then, reptiles. Here, incomplete four chambers are present in heart, which means to complete atria or auricles, to incomplete ventricle, which means the interventricular septum is not well developed in reptiles. But crocodiles are the reptiles which are exclusively having complete four-chambered heart. Then next, birds or aves which are having four-chambered heart with two atria completely separated, two auricles or two atria and two ventricles which are also completely separated. Then mammals which are also having four-chambered heart with two atria and two ventricles. Next slide. Okay, let us discuss the structure of heart, mammals' heart. Okay, the heart is a muscular organ in most animals which pumps blood through the blood vessels of the circulatory system. Okay, heart is mesodermal in origin, which means it is formed from the mesoderm in the embryonic development. Then blood provides the body with oxygen, nutrients, as well as assisting the removal of metabolic waste. These are the functions of heart. And next slide. Okay, we have to discuss the structure of heart. First, we have to know about the location and the shape of the heart. Firstly, the human heart is in the middle of the thorax. Thorax, which means the upper region. I mean, the diaphragm, it separates the body, I mean the trunk, into two parts, two portions. Upper body part is thorax, which is having lungs, heart, all these are there. And also bottom of the diaphragm, which is having his stomach, liver, all these are present. So that is abdomen. Upper portion is thorax. So the human heart is present in the middle of the thorax, with its apex pointing the left. Slightly it is located left side. Left means entirely it is not located. Slightly, okay, the apex pointing to the left. The human heart is situated in the middle mediastinum. Mediastinum is a cavity which is present located between the two lungs. So the cavity is a mediastinum cavity. The heart is situated in the mediastinum cavity. Okay, approximately it is present between the I am mentioning T5 to T8, which means these are the vertebrae, thoracic vertebrae. T5, which means the fifth thoracic vertebrae, and T8 means the eighth thoracic vertebrae. Between them the heart is situated. It is in the shape of fist of the individual. So the size of the size and the shape of the individual is different from one another. So the fist of the individual, we can imagine the shape and size of the individual's heart. Next slide. Okay, this is the diagram of the heart. Just look at the heart once. Here the external structure of heart. We have to discuss the external and internal structure of heart, anatomy of the heart. This is the external structure of heart, just like a reservoir. Okay, firstly, a double membraneed sac called pericardium surrounds the heart and attaches to the mediastinum. Okay, it is very important. Heart is surrounded by a double membraneed sac or the layer, which is called pericardium, which means the heart is also called cardium. The cardium means the heart is surrounded by a double layer, I mean membraneed layer, which is called pericardium, which means it surrounds the cardium, I mean heart, hence it is called pericardium. The pericardium is having, I mean, they are two membranes. They are, I mean, it is double membrane, hence it is having two layers. Between them there is a space, a pericardial space, which allows the pericardial fluid. Okay, the pericardial fluid protects the heart from the external shocks. Next, the back surface of the heart lies near the vertebral column. So it is nearer to the vertebral column, the back side, I mean back surface. And the front surface sits behind the sternum and rib cages. It's very important. And the front surface sits behind the sternum and rib cage. The upper part of the heart is the attachment point for several large blood vessels, the vena cava, aorta or aorta, and pulmonary trunk. These are the upper part of the heart is an attachment point for several large blood vessels. Blood vessels, which means arteries and veins. These are the blood vessels and also capillaries in tissues. These are the major blood vessels are three types: arteries, veins, and capillaries. So here the vena cava is a major, bigger, larger veins. So once just back to the slide here. This is the diagram of the heart external. Here, just look at once. This is the aorta. Okay, red colored blood vessel. It's a artery. I mean, systemic left systemic arch. It is also called left systemic arch or left systemic artery or aorta, major aorta or greater aorta, whatever it is. It is the largest blood vessel in our body. Next, this is pulmonary trunk, which means pulmonary arch or pulmonary trunk. It is divided into two branches. This is one branch, this one is two branches. Again, it is also divided into again two branches: left pulmonary arteries, right pulmonary arteries. Okay, then this is a superior vena cava or pre-caval vein. This is post-caval vein or inferior vena cava. Okay. Next slide. The upper part of the heart is located at the level of the third costal cartilage. The lower tip of the heart, the apex lies to the left of the sternum, which means 8 to 9 centimeters from the mid sternal line. Between the it is just between the junction of the fourth and fifth ribs near their articulation with the costal cartilages. Okay, next slide. Next. Okay, here the internal structure of heart. Okay, look at once. LS of the heart. Because we have to take the longitudinal section of the heart. Because we have to take the longitudinal section of the heart, and there are upper chambers and lower chambers. here the upper chambers are arteries, lower chambers are ventricles. Ventricles are larger chambers than the arteries or atria. Okay. When we observe the atria, first atria or arteries. Atria is plural, atrium is singular. Atrium, it is a Latin word which means an entry hall. Is an entry hall. Hall means a spacious area. Is an upper chamber. The atrium is a is the upper chamber. Humans have two atria or two arcles which are separated by atrial septum or auricular septum. It separates the two atria. Here, this is this look at once. This one and this one. This is the right atrium or right auricle. This is the left atrium or left auricle. These both left and right atria are separated by a atrial septum in the middle. There are two atria in the human heart. The left atrium receives the pure blood from the pulmonary circulation through pulmonary veins, which means we inhale and inspire oxygen from outside. So the lungs retain the oxygen in the alveoli. There is a connection with the capillaries. Alveoli, they are having the contact with the capillaries. The capillaries, they exchange the gases. I mean, the exchange of gases takes place at the alveoli of the lungs. So capillaries, they receive. I mean, the blood of the capillaries receives the oxygen from the alveoli, and they liberates the blood of the capillaries. Pulmonary capillaries liberates the CO2. So CO2 it sends out. Then here there are two atria in the human heart. I have discussed earlier. The left atrium receives the pure blood from the pulmonary circulation, which means from the lungs. It receives the blood from the lungs through pulmonary veins. So the pulmonary veins, they carry the pure blood or oxygenated blood from the lungs to the left atrium of the heart. Then the right atrium receives the impure blood or deoxygenated blood from the all body parts except lungs, because pulmonary veins, they receive the pure blood from the lungs. Remaining all body parts, the veins, I mean the right atrium receives the impure blood from the body parts through vena cava. Vena cava, which means superior and inferior vena cava. So this is a venous circulation. Next slide. The opening of the coronary sinus into the right atrium is guarded by a semicircular fold, which is called tebaceous wall. It's a wall. So valves are mainly used for they prevent the backflow. So the opening of the coronary sinus into the right atrium is guarded by a semicircular fold, which is called tebaceous wall. Generally, when we observe the surface of the external structure of the heart, the ventricles, I mean surface of the ventricles, are having the coronary veins and coronary arteries. Left and right, coronary veins and coronary arteries. Coronary veins, they receive the deoxygenated blood from the myocardium of the heart, and they send, they carry the impure blood. Coronary veins carry the impure blood into the coronary sinus, not directly into the right atrium of the heart. Then the coronary sinus, it leads to the right atrium of the heart. The coronary sinus, the opening of the coronary sinus into the right atrium is guarded by tebaceous valve. Then the valve is situated at the base of the inferior vena cava or pre-caval vein. It may vary in size or be completely absent. The opening of inferior vena cava into the right atrium is guarded by Eustachian valve, but it becomes ruminant and non-functional after the embryonic development. Okay, next slide. The atria receive blood while relaxed, which is called, the relaxation is called diastole. Then they contract, which is systole, to move blood to ventricle, because both atria receive the blood from the blood vessels, veins. So they have to carry the blood, the blood should be flown into the ventricles of the heart from the atria. All animals with a closed circulatory system have at least one atrium. The atrium was formerly called auricle. I have discussed earlier that the term is still used to describe this chamber in some other animals, such as a mollusca, which is a invertebrate phylum. Next slide. Atria and ventricles are separated by atrioventricular septum, transverse septum. It contains atrioventricular apertures. Right atrioventricular aperture is guarded by tricuspid valves, and also the left atrioventricular aperture which is surrounded by bicuspid valves. Okay, once again I'm repeating this: the right atrioventricular aperture is guarded by tricuspid valve, whereas the left atrioventricular aperture is guarded by bicuspid valve or mitral valve. It's very important. These valves prevent the backflow of the blood. Once they enter the ventricles of the heart, the valves, they get closed to prevent the backflow from the ventricles to the atria. Next slide. So let us discuss the ventricles. The ventricle is one of two large chambers toward the bottom of the heart that collect and expel blood received from an atrium towards the peripheral beds within the body and lungs. The atrium, an adjacent or upper heart chamber that is smaller than a ventricle, primes the pump. The two ventricles are separated by an interventricular septum. Next slide. In a four-chambered heart, such as that in humans, there are two ventricles that operate in a double circulatory system, the right ventricle pumps blood into pulmonary circulation to the lungs, and the left ventricle pumps blood into the systemic circulation through aorta. Systemic circulation, which means all body parts except lungs, because the that is the pulmonary circulation. The circulation which is related with the lungs, that is pulmonary circulation. The relation, I mean the contact between the body parts except the lungs and the heart, which is systemic circulation. Ventricles have thicker walls. They are having thicker walls than atria, because the walls of the atria, which are thinner than the walls of the ventricles, and generate higher blood pressure, because they are pumping chambers. They pump the blood to all vital parts and tissues and cells. Next slide. Okay. And the physiological load on the ventricles requiring pumping of blood throughout the body and lungs is much greater than the pressure generated by the atria to fill the ventricles. Further, the left ventricle has thicker walls than the right, because it needs to pump blood to most of the body, while the right ventricle fills only lungs. We have discussed earlier, that is the pulmonary circulation. Next slide. Okay. On the inner walls of the ventricles are irregular muscular columns called trabeculae carinae or columnae carinae or meaty ridges. Trabeculae carinae or columnae carinae or meaty ridges. So on the thinner walls of the ventricles are irregular, there is no flat surface, ups and downs. So they are called trabeculae carinae or columnae carinae or meaty ridges. These ridges cover all of the inner ventricular surfaces except that of conus arteriosus in the right ventricles. There are three types of muscles. The third type, the papillary muscles, give origin at their apices to the carda tendinae or tendinous cords or heart strings, which attach to the cusps of the tricuspid valve and to the mitral valve. This is very simple, because the papillary muscles, some of the ridges, carda tendinae, they swell, they become, they attain conical shape, the conical structures which are called papillary muscles. The papillary muscles are attached with the heart string or carda tendinae. Ridges, which are columnae carinae. Some of the columnae carinae, they become conical structures, which are called papillary muscles. The papillary muscles are attached with the heart string or carda tendinae or tendinous cord or heart strings, which are attached with the tricuspid valves. The tricuspid valves are present at the right atrioventricular aperture, whereas the mitral valve or bicuspid valve, which are present at the left atrioventricular aperture. So these are attached with the carda tendine. Literally, they are protected by the carda tendine. To next, nodal tissues. Nodal tissues are the specialized tissues. So nodal tissue, it is a unique type of tissue that has both muscular and nervous characteristics. Okay, next slide please. It can be found at two points in the heart, the sinoatrial node or sinoauricular node, shortly SA node, and the atrioventricular node, which is also called shortly AV node. It is responsible for coordinating the cardiac cycle, which means a heartbeat. Next, SA node is present at the near opening of superior vena cava or precaval vein into the right atrium. It consists of specialized cardiomyocytes. It has the ability to generate action potentials, hence it is the first pacemaker. Next slide please. Next slide. Next slide please. Okay. AV node, I mean atrioventricular node, lies at the lower back section of the internal septum near the opening of the coronary sinus, and conducts the normal electrical impulse. It is a relay point, actually, from the atrium to the ventricles. It acts as a relay point, already I have discussed, between SA node and his bundle. Okay, AV node is the second pacemaker, which is exclusively present in mammals. So the first pacemaker is SA node, I mean sinoauricular or sinoatrial node, which is the first pacemaker, which means it generates the action potential, so which is essential for the contraction of the atria. Then the AV node, which receives the action potential, I mean signals, the electric signals from the SA node, it sends the signals to the AV bundle or his bundle or bundle of his, which is shortly called BH. BH means a bundle of his. His bundle, which means HB shortly, AV bundle. AV means atrioventricular bundle, lies in the interventricular septum. Interventricular septum, which separates the both ventricles. It is a collection of, I mean the his bundle is a collection of heart muscles specialized for electrical conduction, means transportation, I mean transfer the electric impulses or the signals to the walls of the ventricle. So then, next slide. As part of electric conduction system of the heart, it transmits the electric impulses from the AV node located between the atria and the ventricles to the point of the apex of the fascicular branches via the bundle branches. The fascicular branches then lead to the Purkinje fibers, which provide the electrical conduction to the ventricles, causing the cardiac muscles of the ventricles to contract at a paced interval. Next slide. Okay. Finally, aortic arches. Aortic arches are the major arteries. Two arteries. There are two major arteries present in mammals, especially human beings. They are pulmonary arch and systemic arch. Okay. Firstly, we have to discuss the pulmonary arch, which arises from the left anterior angle of the right ventricle. its opening, I mean the opening of the pulmonary arch is guarded by the pulmonary walls, semilunar walls. Actually they are three semilunar walls which are pulmonary walls, and the pulmonary arch carries impure blood or deoxygenated blood to the lungs. I mean it pumps the deoxygenated blood. Deoxygenated blood, which means it contains mostly CO2. So high amount of CO2 is present in the deoxygenated blood. The systemic arch arises from the left ventricle and transports pure or oxygenated blood, which means it contains a high amount of oxygen, to different body parts through its branches except lungs. Okay, next slide. Okay, the pulmonary and aortic walls are made up of three semilunar flaps each. Actually the pulmonary walls are present at the opening of pulmonary arch into the right ventricle of the heart, whereas the aortic valves are present at the opening of systemic arch into the left ventricle of the heart. A fibrous strand known as ligamentum arteriosum is present at the point of contact of the systemic and pulmonary arches. Actually ligamentum arteriosum is the remnant, the rudiment structure of the ductus arteriosus in the embryonic development. Actually ductus arteriosus, which connects the systemic and pulmonary arches in the embryonic stage, whereas it becomes rudiment and remnant structure. Next slide please. Okay, here the circulation of blood is the flow chart. Okay, from various body parts, vena cava, I mean superior and inferior vena cava, they collect the deoxygenated blood from all body parts except lungs. Deoxygenated blood means, we have discussed earlier, deoxygenated blood which contains mostly CO2, high amount of CO2. It is also called impure blood. Okay. They carry, I mean the vena cava carry the deoxygenated blood into the right atrium of the heart. Then the deoxygenated blood enters right ventricle of the heart through right atrioventricular aperture. Then the deoxygenated blood enters the pulmonary arch from the right ventricle of the heart. Then it leads to lungs from the pulmonary arch. Okay, there the pulmonary capillaries, from the pulmonary capillaries the CO2 is liberated from the blood and it is sent out via respiratory tract. Then the blood of the capillaries, they receive and collect the oxygen from the alveoli of the lungs, and the blood which becomes pure blood, which means oxygenated blood, high amount of oxygen is present in that. The oxygenated blood is carried by pulmonary veins from the lungs. They carry, I mean the pulmonary veins carry the oxygenated blood into the left atrium of the heart. From the left atrium, the oxygenated blood enters the left ventricle through left atrioventricular aperture. Then the oxygenated blood leads to the left systemic arch from the left ventricle. Then from the left systemic arch, the oxygenated blood is I mean the left systemic arch, it distributes oxygenated blood to all body parts with all its branches. Hence, the left systemic artery is the greatest artery in the body. This is about the blood circulation. So, we have successfully discussed about the structure of heart. So, thank you. Thank you, one and all.